I am very excited to have Evie Ladin and Eric Pearson in the studio. I had no idea 24 hours ago that I had a live interview today. They played last night at the A Church, and they blew me away how good they are. And, you know, when my station manager, director, asked if they would be interested, they did it. And I was like, I was shocked. I was like, oh, my, on my way out before I take vacation, I got a really cool interview with these cool people. So, K-Hen listeners, welcome, Evie and Eric, to the K-Hen Hen House. Welcome, guys, man.
Good morning.
What an incredible show you put on last night.
Hey, thanks.
I was blown away.
Thank you.
First time in Salida.
Well, I hope you guys come back.
I hope so, too. Yes. Oh, man. It's beautiful up here.
And, you know, I didn't know I had an interview yesterday. In fact, I didn't know I had an interview when I went to your show, so I did very little research except for this morning on you guys. But, man, I heard that you are a former DJ for a local community radio station.
Indeed, in Bloomington, Indiana, WFHB.
Awesome. How did you get started in that?
I was living in Bloomington. I was dancing with a dance company called Rhythm and Shoes, and we had a touring schedule of like 2-3 weeks on and 2-3 weeks off. And the radio station's just right downtown, and I loved it. And I was offered a show, and I shared it. It was called Throat Culture. And shared the show with someone who covered it when I was on the road, but a big fan of, you know, just like an open plan radio station and all the music that came through, and I made mixtapes of my shows. And
what kind of genre did you play?
Everything? Throat culture. So it was mostly, things I like. a lot of singing, a lot of Americana, mostly, whether new or old. Country, folk, singer-songwriters, different stuff that came through.
How did you get out to San Francisco and form the Stairwell Sisters? How did that journey come apart?
Love, exciting and new. Yeah, I was living in Bloomington, and I was leaving the dance company and moved to Chicago, but the last project we did was with my now partner of many years, Keith Terry, and he lived out in the Bay Area for a long time. And so I moved out there as an experiment, and within a couple months I was teaching clogging, and I was all of a sudden in a band in the Stairwell Sisters. Everyone's like, you got to meet so-and-so, you got to meet so-and-so, and next thing you know, that was my first band.
Just clicked, huh?
Yeah, so I kind of moved from doing more dance to more music, but there's always, as you saw last night, a real mix of music and dance in everything we do.
And feel free to dance here, too.
room.
In this closet of a studio. So where are you guys going next? I mean, you played last night here. Where's your next gig at?
Well, we're playing at Black Rose Acoustic Society up in the Springs tonight. Tonight, Friday. Yeah. They play on Fridays. Sorry. I didn't sleep too well last night. we're playing there on Friday, and that's, you know, a do-over from 2020. We were supposed to be there in October of 2020, so
yeah, we all know how that went.
Mm-hmm, yeah. Glad to finally make that date happen. And let's see. Saturday we're doing a house show in Longmont that's open to the public, and Sunday we'll be at Swallow Hill in Denver.
Swallow Hill.
Kicking that off with a banjo climber banjo workshop in the afternoon, and then a concert that night in Tufts Hall. So I really hope people come out. So, you know, you yourself said you hadn't heard of us before we came here, even though we've been touring and professional musicians for all of our careers, mm-hmm. both me and Eric.
Yeah.
We're not necessarily household names, but that's the way of folk music. And so I hope that people come out. You can attest that it's a super fun show.
And once I did my research, I was like, holy, these guys are good. I mean, they're top notch. I mean, real top notch. I'm excited to have you guys in here. I'm just giddy. So, would you like to play something?
Yeah, sure. We'll kick it off here. We got a banjo and a guitar. So I haven't done my full warm-up, but hopefully it'll be all right. Won't stretch too far. Here's a song that I wrote called Down to the Door. Well, come down to the front of the hills, where the mist sails away. The bubble grows on the way.
Wow. Man, Edie, during your concert, you talked a little bit about you got started in music. You started playing banjo at 8 years of age?
I did.
How did you get started in that? Did your parents get you into that? Or?
Well, my dad was an avid old-time music appreciator, and he fell in love with Appalachian music in the 50s in New York City, late 50s in New York City. So, you know, it was during the first folk scare. And our home was pretty much open to musicians and cloggers traveling through, or traveling up from the South for the first time, or whatever it was. So there were always people in and out of the house. And hang on a second, I'm getting hot. The weather is like, you're hot, you're cold, you're hot, you're cold.
Oh, we got to dress in layers around here.
Uh-oh.
And you talked about folk before it went, before it went electric, before Bob Dylan, you know, screwed it up, making it electric. I remember the protest when he went electric at Newport. So,
I got my sweatshirt strung up on my headphones. All right, well, we'll figure that out. Let's see. Well, you know John Cohn and the New Lost City Ramblers, probably.
Yes.
And so he was staying with us once, and he just said, "You girls should play the banjo." And next thing I know, we had a banjo, and we had lessons, and that was my first instrument.
That's interesting. 8 years. Eric, how did you get started in music?
Well, let's see. I think probably I started in music because I saw the Hard Day's Night, the Beatles movie, and I saw the Beatles getting chased around by all those girls, and I thought, oh, that'll be great. I want that. That sounds good. And so my neighbors and I decided we were going to, we set up this little toy slide, like this, I forget who made it, it was like a toy slide in my room, and that was our stage, and so we would pretend to be the Beatles.
How old were you then?
And that was like second grade, maybe, and then we decided in third grade that we liked Kiss, so we wanted to be mini Kiss, and so we all started taking guitar lessons then, and that was kind of the beginning of it. I sort of quit guitar for a little bit, and then and got more into classical music, and then but I didn't learn about old time music until college, when some friends of mine who played really well were playing in the Staircase, and it sounded so great, so I just went and I followed the sound up the staircase and heard all these great sounds and these old time tunes, and I was like, what are you doing? And they were like, can I just listen? And they said, come on. No, you can listen. You got to go get your guitar. And so that was it from then on. Just, I played a lot of old time music. We'd go to parties and then later on went to festivals and stuff like that. And so, yeah.
So Eric is an incredible bandmate for many reasons, but one of them being that, you know, it's hard to find people who really get old-time music but also have expansive ears, so that there's a lot of flexibility with what people understand about old-time music, but there's such a depth and groove and a history to it, and just the deep brown and black roots, even though it's really associated with Anglo culture, and how it's very different from bluegrass. And, you know, now bluegrass is sort of a catch-all term for anything with a banjo, but I don't actually play any bluegrass. People are shocked to find out that.
What?
But I've always played old-time banjo, but I've been writing songs forever. And so, like that last one, you know, a mashup of an old-time tune and a song I wrote, and a lot of our music sort of follows that path. And it's nice to have the foundation, but also have those expansive ears that we both have from listening to a lot of different kinds of music and playing different stuff.
Your style of banjo playing has been described as claw hammer, which is a very unique, watching you play that, than people that are picking with all five fingers.
Yeah.
It's very interesting, and you're very proficient. You're teaching that. You have online classes on how to play claw hammer banjo, right?
Yeah, I do. I teach through Peghead Nation. I mean, claw hammer is the oldest style. It comes straight from Africa. And they have lots of different instruments with like a short string, like the fifth string, short string, and from one to many long strings. And the clawhammer style, you know, is a way of getting that drone on the fifth string and a lot of melody elsewhere. I play the instrument as a mix of melody, harmony, and rhythm. I really play it as a percussive instrument. I started out more as a percussive dancer. My course on Peghead Nation, if you want to study any kind of stringed instrument in actually several different traditional styles, Peghead Nation is a great company, and it's a subscription service. And if any banjo players out there, I can give you a code, is EVIEL. We'll get you a free month to just check out that banjo class if you want.
I think my banjo player, Tom Plant, already signed up for it.
All right. Well, Tom was the one that brought us to town.
Right.
So how is he your banjo player?
He's played for me personally in the studio, so he's
I hear he's a really phenomenal bluegrass banjo player.
Oh, he's incredible. Yeah. He and his wife are just delightful people. So
that's great.
She's quite the upright bass player, too. So.
He saw that we were coming to Colorado and got in touch and was like, can I set up a show in Salida? And I was, sure, let's do it. So he's responsible for getting us here.
And we're thankful for that. We're very thankful.
We are, too. We've had a great time here. So it's really nice.
Yeah, the A Church is such a beautiful venue.
It's a great listening room.
And it really sounded so good, and the floor is great for dancing. And
so you had quite the all-star doing sound for you. have you met Bruce or?
Well, I met him a bunch last night.
Okay.
I feel like we're gonna listen to some of his music on our way out of town, because I feel like some of his music came through the radio station when I was on the air.
So
I'm a dulcimer, and
he plays pretty much anything proficient with strings on it, and he's very proficient with all of it, and he's
cool. Local treasure.
Yeah, he definitely
absolutely
is.
Yeah, it seems like we had a bunch of local treasures there last night.
Yeah.
So I do want to remind folks that we are in the middle of our fund drive, and we could sure use your support. If you do support, am I coming through?
Yes, you are.
Damn, I don't have a headphone, but anyway, if you support the kind of effort that Jim puts forth to bring live music to the studio and all the musicians that play around town at our various venues, please go to kn.org and click on the support button. Or better yet, you can stop down at 123 East 3rd Street and listen to these guys in the studio live. So anyway, that's the end of my fun drive talk.
Unless you
wanted to add something.
Well, when we drove into town, we drove right past the building, and I took a picture. I was like, that is the cutest little community radio station I have ever seen. And I'm so delighted that we ended up back here in the studio today.
As are we.
Oh, me too. Man, what a finish to my year of interviews. Wow, thank you guys. Do you guys have time for a couple more songs?
Sure.
Yeah, we can hang out for a bit. We just want to get out into
the... Yeah, you want to get up to the springs, avoid the rush hour traffic.
Actually, we want to get out into the hills a little bit before we go. I mean, why come all this way and not walk around and, you know, breathe in some of this incredible mountain air? And it's a beautiful day today.
Thank you for taking the time out of your day and coming into the studio.
Sure,
I really appreciate it.
We're going to play a song called Under the Waterline. And I'm sure you can identify as you get older. Gravity is real, and my favorite place to be is in the water. Thank you.
song and the words. Is writing music has always come natural to you, or?
I really.
Did you write poetry when you were young, or?
No, I was pacing up and down on the bus stop in junior high, writing songs in my head. But I don't know. Growing up playing a lot of traditional music, I felt like, who am I to write a song? And it took me a while to get around to it. But now we've got, I don't know, 5 or 6 records out. With a lot of my songs on it, always a mix of original and traditional stuff. And I must say, like, you know, I think one of the reasons you haven't heard of us before is we kind of fall through, you know, it's like the bluegrass festivals say that we're too old time and the songwriter festivals were too old time, but the old time festivals were too songwriter. So, you know, people like it. I come back to people like it, but they usually don't know what they're coming in to see. So, you know, the more we tour, the more people know us. And I love the intimate listening venues. That's really where we thrive.
Where is your website?
EvieLadin.com.
Oh, that's a good one.
And, you know, I'm the only Evie Ladin on the internet, so if you can spell it however you like, and you'll find me.
Very good.
Yeah.
Do you guys have time for one more before you head out?
At least, yeah, sure.
Okay. Good deal.
I thought we'd do a song we did last night, Glory.
Yeah.
This is on our most recent record, Caught on a Wire. And,
We've got matching rings.
Hey, yeah, that's my wedding ring.
Yeah, my daughter gave that to me when she was 4 years old.
Oh, that's sweet.
Oh, yeah.
It's, we chose the, I actually had a silver version, because we've been dating for a while, and he said, I want people to know you're connected. I was like, well, get me a ring then. So we just had this silver ring, and that's still how we sleep 22 years later, all wrapped around each other.
That's awesome.
That was a good thing. We're going to tune here on the radio. That's really pleasant.
we thank you for that.
You do, I know.
The jokes about tuning a banjo.
We tune because you care. Yeah, we'll also put out there that I do teach live group banjo lessons, 2 levels through the Freight and Salvage in Berkeley. And I moved online and I've kept it online because then I have a Tuesday night gig when I'm on tour and adults tune in from anywhere. So you're just 1 hour difference. So it's not even that late. If anyone wants to jump in on live classes with me through the Freight and Salvage, that's all on the website too. It's on Tuesday nights.
Very good.
Yeah, the Freight and Salvage is a great Berkeley, California institution. They have like they've always had concerts, but since they've had a new building, they do a lot of like classes, and then a lot of them went online with the pandemic and stuff. So it's like become a real folk school as well as.
And I find, you know, now that we're all adept at Zoom and all of that, adults really like it when nobody can hear them play. So they like being in their little muted Zoom boxes, you know, for a while, so they can mess around and not be feel embarrassed or whatever. So I really love teaching those classes. And both of us, you know, we tour a lot. Eric also plays with a band called the Crooked Jades and a storyteller, Diane Forlatt. And I do a lot of stuff on the body music side of the spectrum with percussive dance and all of that. But both of us are really, think it's really important to do a lot of participatory stuff and facilitating people's experience in doing. Music is to do, dancing is to do, singing is to do. We had a great singing workshop yesterday and just feel like it's the things that keep us healthy and connected to community is this connection through music and dance, just like what you're doing here.
That's kind of how we like to connect to the community, too. I'd like to think that we are a thread that binds.
Mm-hmm.
So,
100%.
Yeah, community radio. Plug for community radio. It's
absolutely
so important. It's like the only thing that's going to get people through. Like, it's so often in emergencies, it's the only way that people have information, can get
about
information
local.
About
yeah.
what's going on in the town and stuff like that. It's vital.
Well, we had a forest fire here, and we were pretty instrumental in getting the information out about that. And of course, during COVID, you know, all the updates and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd like to think that we are the thread that binds.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If
great.
You support that, go to khan.org and hit support.
Yeah, please do. Well, we'll play another mashup here. It's a tune called Valley Forge and a song I wrote called Glory. I hope you like it. Thanks so much for having us. One, two, three.
Night you played a Grateful Dead song, and I don't even remember which one it was.
Mississippi Half Step.
Mississippi
Uptown Toodaloo.
Toodaloo. Mm-hmm. How did you get into the Dead? And, you know, being in San Francisco, you're probably kind of exposed to it, I imagine, to a degree.
Well, this was before that. That's what brought me out to California for the first time a long time ago. But I got into the Dead in college, as one does. And, you know, growing up in the old-time music scene, it was not that different. People hanging out in the parking lot, playing music together, making a community. And that's what I grew up doing, was going to these festivals where I know now a lot of people have grown up going to festivals, but You know, we went to the very first folk festival, Pete Seeger's Folk Festival, in upstate New York when I was 3 years old. And my parents were really into it. And so I'm Gen X, so there were like hardly any kids our age coming up in it. But we grew up, you know, being barefoot and muddy and running around with lots of people playing music.
Feral children.
So it fits right into the Grateful Dead scene, doesn't it?
Pretty much. I got my first Dead show in 73. I was in high school. And you know what? I got it. I got on the bus, you know, and then the very next year in 74, he came out with his Old and In the Way album.
Exactly. That was the first one that got me.
And that introduced me into bluegrass. And I've been a hillbilly ever since. It's like, oh my gosh, this is good stuff.
Well, I feel like a lot of people got to bluegrass through the Grateful Dead, and I went the other way because I came from trad music. And yeah, and just really, my dad was saying, why are you into the Grateful Dead? Imagine a thick Bronx accent. When I went into a Grateful Dead, I was like, Dad, they do Deep Ellum Blues and Hang Me, Oh Hang Me. And then I heard him telling people at the Fiddler's Convention, oh, the Grateful Dead do Deep Ellum. I was like, all these people were deadheads that then got into old-time music. So it's a great crossover.
It is.
Yeah.
Guys, thank you for coming into the studio, and I wish you very safe travel mercies on your next gig and stuff. You're going up to Colorado Springs into Denver for several gigs.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we come back around every year or so. So
please come back.
Hopefully we'll come back.
And hopefully, man, anything I can do to help promote your show and your music, let me know. Always welcome here at the K-Hen Hen House.
So. All right. Thanks very much.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Thanks for having us.
Thank you very much.